This program is brought to you by thepodcastfactory.com.
Hi, my name is Igor Kheifets, and this is the List Building Lifestyle, the only podcast which delivers cutting-edge conversion strategies from the online trenches straight to your earbuds. Download the transcript of today's episode and all future episodes at listbuildinglifestyleshow.com. I also invite you to grab a free copy of the Wealthy List Builder Survival Guide at listbuildinglifestyleshow.com/survival. And now, once again, it's time to claim your list building lifestyle.
You are listening to the List Building Lifestyle Show. Welcome back, boys and girls, to another edition. Here is the I-Emmer from Israel, Mr. Igor Kheifets.
The I-Emmer. Awesome. That's such a concise intro. Yeah, yeah. But you know what? I have a question. Do we confuse people at this point? Like, I think I have like a whole list of nicknames or, you know, whatever you want to labels. So I'm just afraid it's going to hurt my branding.
Uh-oh. We need to stick with one then. We need to stick with one. But wait a second. With this many shows, wouldn't that get boring?
I guess it can be. But, you know, Coca-Cola has been around for like 100 years and we're still drinking it, right?
Yeah, yeah. But I think you got to hit people from different angles. I think that there's different levels of awareness. A smart guy taught me that. So you got to hit it from different angles.
Well, salute to you, my friend. You've listened to the last episode.
What's good today, Igor?
Well, today we're talking about swipes. As promised, you know, I want to teach you, or no, ooh, I want to show ooh. You. I want to show you. I want to present you with an opportunity to discover how to write a great email swipe for your solo ad. Because as you know, the process of buying solo ads, you're sort of obligated. And when I say sort of, because you're not really obligated, but a lot of the, you know, many solo vendors prefer for you to provide them with a swipe. But you're sort of obligated to provide an email creative to the vendor that you're hiring to run your traffic. Now, frankly speaking, if they allow you to do so, and I say that because we don't, like if you work with my agency, I control the swipe, I don't let you to write your own just because I know my list better, I know how they respond, I know I control the lingo, I know the angles I'm supposed to hit, right? I can look at your offer and within a few minutes come up with a swipe. Not a problem for me, but many of the solo vendors, it is a problem for them, mainly because of two reasons. First reason is because they don't really understand copywriting. I mean, they know some basics. They try to stick to formulas, but they suck because most people suck. That's okay. And I don't say it in a mean way, like I'm better than they are, although I am really much better than they are when it comes to copywriting. I'm just saying that they are not investing as much time into studying that skill as I do. They focus on other things and, you know, it's their business. All the power to them. Now, the second reason is because they're lazy and they prefer for you to write the swipe. In fact, if they could, they would give you the login details to their, you know, email autoresponder account. So you go load it in, yeah, because they don't want to do it anyway. So when it comes to solo ads, you better have an email swipe because you're going to use it 90% of the time. Now, this is why it's so critical for me to help you understand what makes a good swipe and what's the purpose of a swipe. Because a lot of people think that the purpose of the swipe that you use on a solo ad is to kind of just sell the product or overcome an objection or maybe build your brand. But none of it is really true. What your solo ad creative is supposed to do is get a targeted and committed click to your squeeze page. Your squeeze page is supposed to generate enough curiosity to get people to opt in, and your sales page is the one that's supposed to be selling. So the mistake I see a lot of people make is, first off, they either use a really generic swipe, which we're going to be talking about down the road, I have a few episodes planned on that, but they either use like a generic clickbait swipe, which doesn't get them the committed click they need, or they almost want you to mail a sales letter, which never works. I mean, it's not going to pull enough clicks, and it's going to be too overwhelming for an email. It's just not the right media for that. Like, I've seen people mail an entire freaking sales letter through an email. That's really scary, really scary stuff for the brain. So that is why I want to give you 5 rules. Okay, it's a 5-step formula, if you will. There's 5 elements. The subject line, so that's the subject, the email title, if you will, whatever you want to call it, the one that shows up in the inbox and that determines whether the person's going to open that email or not. And then there is the intro, which is the actual email, like the intro, the body and the call to action. So I'm not sure why I said five, it's four. So it's a subject line, and then it's a three-piece email swipe. Okay, now we're going to get back to the subject line in a little bit. First, I want to talk about the actual email creative. So the reason I break it down to three different parts is because each part serves a purpose. The purpose of your intro is to get the person to read the next line. So literally, the purpose of the first line of your email is to get them to read the second line. You kind of have to get them on a greased slide almost to suck them into that email after they open the email thanks to the subject line. And what you do in order to create that, okay, you need to cut to the chase, no foreplay, okay, no verbal foreplay here at all. Just cut to the chase and describe the problem your target market is experiencing. Now, the reason you want to talk about the problem and not any solution and not tell them a story, right, is because there's nothing more interesting to the client, to the potential prospect you're working with, than their own problems. Like, they literally walk around all day long, and all they think about, unless they get sort of like shocked out of it, all they think about is the problem that they're experiencing right now, the biggest one. Right. And you know what I'm talking about, John, right? I mean, you ever had a problem like when you were adopting? I mean, isn't that what you were thinking about all the time?
Yeah, that's a good point. Everything, anything that had to do with adoption caught our attention because that's the world that we were in.
Yeah, exactly. And it was always about that because that's the biggest problem right now. So if you would like to attract your ideal customer, the best chance you have of doing so is by getting a customer that's problem aware, that is wondering how to solve that problem. And so you need to figure out what is that problem your product solves and talk about it. Talk about it in the intro to your email in the most concise and easiest way possible. Okay, that's how you gain people's attention. Then you move to the body of the email. Now, the body, what it does, it teases, notice the keyword here, teases the solution to the reader's problem by talking about how it's different from all the other similar solutions this reader has been promised in the past. And I assure you, they were promised something. They were promised at least a couple of other solutions that they did not act on. That's how the marketplace works. If you're advertising to that list, make no bones about it, that your competitors are advertising as well, and your prospect is now at a point where they're aware of the fact that they have a problem, and they probably have seen a couple of potential solutions. And so your job in the body of your email is to clearly position why your solution is effective and why it's different from everything else they tried before, because if it seems like something they already tried, they will immediately throw it out. They will immediately trash it and kind of disqualify just based on the fact that they supposedly tried it, even though they didn't. And the last part of the email, the third part, is the call to action. Now remember, in the body, I told you, you're supposed to tease the person. You're not supposed to reveal everything about your product. You're not supposed to go into the features and the benefits. You're just supposed to tease the solution, perhaps even paint this ideal scenario where the prospect no longer experiences the solution and sort of like hint into how it's going to happen. But then in the last part, the call to action, you have to tell the reader what she needs to do to learn more about the solution. Now, this is not a place for you to start hyping things up. It's not a place for you to be funny, clever, or creative. Just tell her where to click. That's about it. That's all the swipe needs to do. So, Jonathan, any questions about the actual creative?
Not so far, but I just want to make or get something clear. So you keep going back and forth between creative and email and swipe. That's all the same thing, right? It's the actual email that goes out to the solo ads that you purchased.
Yeah, that's right. And the reason I'm using the word swipe a lot, and then I kind of intertwine it with creative, because anyone who comes from the offline business world, for some reason, that's what they call it, the creative. And anyone who's online, they say it's a swipe. So that is why a swipe and the creative are both the same thing, which is the email. Kind of like a squeeze page and a capture page being the same thing, which is the page that captures the prospect's email address.
Got it. Thank you.
You're very welcome, my friend. So the swipe, again, it's the intro, it's the body and the call to action, and each has a purpose. Now, the most important part for your solo ad by far, of course, is the subject line. Now, the subject line is tricky because, especially if you're doing e-sign solo ads, which is something we're going to be discussing in future episodes, where you're not guaranteed the clicks, the subject line alone can result in your entire promotion bombing completely because nobody will open the damn email. So the faith of your entire campaign sometimes can be literally hinging on how good your subject line is. Now, the good news for you is that Uncle Igor has two formulas you can use to write a really, really good subject line that gets the right people to pay attention and open your email. So the formulas are very simple. The first one is how to get insert outcome they want here without insert thing they hate here. So an example, how to make money online without previous experience, how to make six figures without a degree, how to start your own business without credit, right? So when I say the thing they hate, what I mean is like the thing that they consider unattainable sometimes, not just the thing that they find quote unquote work, right? So it could be a lot of different things. But what's important is that you promise them the benefit that they desire desperately without the thing they really, really, really hate or really, 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 really afraid of. So that's the first formula. Works every single time. Now, the second formula is for people who are experiencing problem. So for people who hate their boss but can't walk away from their job, for people who hate the sound of their own voice, for people who suffer from lower back pain. Now, if I came across this subject line, for people who suffer from lower back pain, exactly a year ago when I was tied to my couch, I mean, I'd be reading that email. I'd be all over the email and all over the solution, regardless of what the email actually said. So remember, you're not going after everyone. What you're doing is you're going after a very specific type of prospect that is experiencing that problem that your product solves right now, and that this problem for them is really, really pressing. So you're trying to get the best possible prospect for your advertising dollars in order to maximize your solo ad ROI.
Makes sense. Now, Igor, I feel like we should mention, or maybe not, I don't know, but this is really what the direct response mythology is, isn't it? Each little piece of it moves your prospect one step closer to the action you want them to take. So the subject line gets them to read the email. The email has the three parts that move them through the copy and get them to your squeeze page. And the squeeze page does the job to bring them into the sales page, right?
Well, yes. So what you're talking about, and I think this is what I'm hearing, is that instead of trying to perceive the marketing process as one huge leap over a Grand Canyon, what you're trying to do is you're building a bridge one piece at a time for them. So they need to take one small step after the next. So I call this concept the concept of micro commitments. So when you email them and they open the subject line or read and open the subject line, that's one micro commitment. They read the email, that's the second one. They click on the link, that's another one. They check out your squeeze page and opt in, that's another one, right? So you're always taking them one small step at a time until they're so deep into it emotionally that they end up buying the product. It is a lot like when you have a hot bath and it's really, really hot. So you don't jump in, but you put your toe in, then the second one, all of a sudden half your leg is in, then you know you're standing on one foot in it, all of a sudden you're sitting down. So even though the bath is still really, really hot, you made your way in because you gradually went in a bit by bit.
Yeah, it reminds me of actually our last episode where you talked about the stages of awareness and kind of the stages of where they are when they're reading the copy and moving them through that. So what I'm seeing here is that there's a sequence of events rather than just some big magical button. There's a sequence of events that have to happen to get the action you want.
Exactly. So it's a strategic sequence of very specific events that have to happen according to this plan, right? It never happens in any other sequence. It has to happen this very specific sequence, and only then it makes sense and it works. And tell me how many times you've seen people try to cut through, right? They try to shortcut their way and they sort of skip all the way to the end. Or they see a guru, or they recognize that a guru is doing something and they only see a part of the puzzle. They try to copy it and it doesn't work. because they're not copying the entire sequence. Rather, what they're trying to do is they're trying to copy just one element, thinking that it's the entire setup.
Right, right. That's one of the reasons why you can't just guess what Igor's doing and try to imitate him on his solo ads. You're going to have to get into Igor's solo ads to know the whole process, because you're only getting a little glimpse in each episode.
Yeah, and that's why it really pays sometimes to play prospect with competing businesses. So if you're trying to build a business that is similar, like if you were trying to build a solo ads business, right, your very, very good move for you would be to play prospect with us at Igor Solo Ads and actually go and buy, because you'll see the entire process laid out and experience it for yourself, so then you can replicate it. Now, obviously, people already have done that, so I have no problem talking about it, but I've done it myself. When I was doing the coaching, I played prospect with Lee McIntyre, who was really successful at the time selling coaching. I was playing prospect with Tony Robbins. In fact, I played prospect with Tony Robbins and actually ended up buying the $10,000 coaching program.
Nice.
Which, of course, you know, I benefited from greatly. It's just I went in playing prospect and ended up buying. It's just ironic, right? But you know, when I went to this program, I learned a bunch of different things that I was able to take to my business and improve it. Again, like playing prospect to observe the entire process is really, really good. And when it comes to email swipes, you know what I see, Johns, and I see a lot of people just trying to steal. Like Dennis was hanging out with these guys who produce somewhere around 80,000 clicks a day, right?
Wow.
And these guys are really powerful mailers, and they do a lot of things that I would consider to be unethical, right? And in some countries, these things are actually illegal, but it's not my... I guess it's not my job here right now to judge them. But basically, what happened was he was like looking at their stuff because they were, for some reason, really open showing it. And they had all our swipes.
Ooh.
Now, of course, I realized that everybody steals our swipes. Everybody steals our emails. But here's the thing. They can be stealing them for as long as they want. They won't produce them anywhere near the kind of results they produce for us, because they've been created for us, by us, with a specific strategy in mind. They're part of the bigger picture, bigger process. What they're trying to do is they try to take like a bolt out of my machine and stick it into their machine, hoping it's going to work just as well. It just doesn't work like that.
Yeah. Steal all you want. You'll never get the magic till you pay. And for everybody out there, playing prospect is also known as funnel hacking, by the way. I do it all the time too.
That's right. And we have an episode about funnel hacking with Russell Brunson, actually. Yeah, so if you Google Russell Brunson and Igor Kheifets, you'll see there's an episode with Russell where he explains the concept, in case you're not familiar with it.
Nice. All right. So, Igor, any parting thoughts as we're wrapping up this episode?
Yeah. There's one thing about solo ad swipes. They're really scary. For some reason, people are really afraid of writing them on their own. Like, I've been paid in upwards of $150 just to write an email like that. I mean, it literally takes me 10 minutes. And for that, people are willing to pay over $100. So what this tells me is that people are really, really afraid of writing their own email swipes, either because they don't think of themselves as great copywriters, or they don't know what to write, or perhaps they're just, I don't know, maybe they're just afraid to screw it up. But in any case, it's not scary. It's an illusion. It's a mirage. If you just follow the formula I gave you today, okay, it's the subject line. You got two formulas for that and a three-step email creative writing sequence. You do that, as long as you know your product, you have no problem writing a really good swipe that's going to pull great committed clicks to your offer when you run the traffic.
Excellent. All right. You want to tease next time?
Yes. Next time, we're talking about how you get scammed with solo ads. In fact, what I'm going to do, I'm going to tell you about four specific ways that solo ad vendors, or I guess look-alike solo ad vendors, you know, people who pretend to be solo ad vendors, end up taking you for your money. I'm going to reveal their tactics so you're aware of what you need to look for when you're dealing with a shady solo ad seller.
All right. So that is a wrap for another List Building Lifestyle Show. We'll be back in your earbuds next time. Thanks for tuning in.
Thank you for listening to the List Building Lifestyle. Make sure to subscribe on iTunes or Google Play to never miss an episode. Because who knows, just one conversion tactic we share on the show might double your list and double your business. download the transcript of today's episode and all future episodes at listbuildinglifestyleshow.com. And don't forget to claim your complimentary copy of the Wealthy List Builder Survival Guide at listbuildinglifestyleshow.com/survival. This is Igor Kheifets, and until next time we talk, have a good one.
This is the PodcastFactory.com.